Calling all cars. A copyrighted program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Lieutenant Lee calling all cars. Attention all cars. Broadcast 159. The killing. Tony Morelli found on the 9th Street Bridge. It looks like a gangster killing. That is all. Harmon. Let me ask you, why do you go to the movies? Why are you tuned into this broadcast? It is because human beings crave the dramatic. We all enjoy the colorful, the romantic, the stirring moments of life. In the most ordinary situations, there can be drama to enrich life experience, even in such a simple situation as driving your car. It is no misstatement to say that some gasolines are dramatic and some are woefully undramatic. Rio Grande Cracked gasoline is indeed dramatic. It is the gasoline of police car performance. It has been specified month after month for emergency use by police of such cities as Oakland, Berkeley, Fresno, Los Angeles, Phoenix, San Diego County, Orange County, Maricopa County, Arizona, and many, many other cities and counties. Can you imagine anything more stirring in everyday affairs than to drive a police car chasing criminals, or a fire engine rushing to save property, or an ambulance speeding to save a life? Yet you can have this same dramatic performance in your own car every day, everywhere you go. For independent Rio Grande dealers offer you exactly the same Rio Grande cracked gasoline that powers more police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment wherever it is sold than any other brand. Why don't you enjoy police car performance in your car? Once again, it is our pleasure to present Chief James D. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department. Chief Davis.
Good evening, friends. Tonight, you will hear the story of a man who was too weak to resist the magnetic pull of easy money. He wasn't a Dillinger, a baby-faced Nelson, or a cold-blooded killer. Yet his crime was just as brutal as any of these gangsters might perpetrate. Even worse was the fact that he broke a trust not only with himself, but with society as a whole, by using his badge of authority as a means of protection. It is hard to believe that any individual, faced constantly with proofs of the stupidity of crime, could defy every tradition and resort to a criminal act. Yet that is just what happened. What his reward for this move was, will be told in tonight's story of the criminal policeman.
Morning in August 1921. In the office of the homicide detail in Los Angeles, detectives Hamilton and Rico idly thumb through reports in an effort to pass the hours away until the dawn shift is over.
Did they get a line on that bird you're looking for? Remember the guy that was going around busting people over the head and then running?
We got a line on him, but I guess he got wise. He just quit appearing.
Funny. Never did make much sense to me anyway. You never tell what these nuts are liable to do.
Well, I'd almost be glad to have another one turn up right now. This dawn grind gets me down. What time do you make it?
Well, it'll be getting along. Yep, 4:30.
Yeah, well, won't be long before the boys will be coming in, and then watch my smoke. Bacon and eggs and a great big help and a shut-eye.
I get it. Homicide, Rico.
Coleman Beaumont. I just found a body out on the 9th Street Bridge.
Why don't you call the morgue? This is the detective bureau.
Because this guy's got three holes in him made by high-powered bullets. It struck me that you might be interested.
Okay, Beaumont, stick right there. We'll be out in a minute.
Something?
Some guy stopped a barrage of lead out on the 9th Street Bridge. Better take a run out and look him over.
I was afraid something would happen to spoil my breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
Nelson's my name. This is Detective Rico. Where's this fellow you called about?
Over there in the gutter. Oh, hadn't moved him, just made sure he was dead.
That couldn't be hard. Hey, he really got it. I know this guy. It's Tony Morelli.
What's his claim to fame?
He had a record. He pulled in a couple of times for larceny, and lately we picked him up on suspicion of bootlegging. He's got friends, though, and we haven't been able to pin anything on him.
Well, looks as though his friends decided to fix things up.
Yeah, it's a racket killing, all right. Three slugs clear through him. Whoever did it wanted to be pretty sure he didn't have any time to talk before he bumped.
Any witnesses, Beaumont?
Not that I know of. I didn't see anybody around when I spotted him.
Well, you better phone for the morgue wagon.
Hey, Tony has a wife and brother living over the other side of town. He didn't say we'd take a run over and see them.
Okay. Beaumont, you stick around and see what you can learn from the people around here that might have heard the shots. Come on, Rico. Looks like Mrs. Morelli is the next stop.
I'm coming for your horse.
Hello, Mrs. Morelli. Remember me, don't you?
Sure. Where's the Tony?
I've got some bad news for you, Mrs. Morelli. Perhaps you'd like to sit down.
You've got the Tony in the jailhouse. He's not to do anything. He's a good man. He's not to do
just
anything.
Just a moment, Mrs. Morelli. Tony's not in jail.
He's not in jail?
No. Tony's dead.
Oh.
He was murdered early this morning.
Oh, Tony's dead. No, that's not right. He's not dead.
We're sorry to have to bring you such bad news, Mrs. Morelli. Oh. Unfortunately, what Detective Rico says is true. Someone shot your husband early this morning.
Oh, Teresa Madonna. Tony, oh, he's such a good man.
What's
oh, Santa
doing?
Maria.
Oh, what's the matter?
Oh, it's Tony. He's a shot.
Oh, Tony, Tony. Stephen, they got him alive.
Who's Stephen?
Oh, he's a copper just like you. He was always coming over to have a drink of a Tony. Oh, I didn't like it. And now look at what's happened. He's a killer, Tony.
What makes you so sure it was Stephen that did it?
Oh, he was a hero with Michael last night about 9:30. They said they was going out and get a drunk. Tony gets too friendly with these fellows. I know something like this would happen. Stevens, he is not good.
You don't like this Stevens much, do you?
I like him. I hate him.
Perhaps you better come down to headquarters and make out a report of all this.
All right.
I don't think there's much of this, Rico. Stevens was investigating the bootlegging going on around here. He probably had something on these people, and they want to put him on a spot.
Yeah, we'll check with him when we get back to the station. You're set, but Morelli, we'll take a run down to Central.
That's all right with me. Just a cop. Bump off of my brother, Tony. I'm going to see that he gets a payback. He couldn't do that and get away with it.
You had a hard night.
Sure. I've been up all night on a party.
Pretty tough job trying to party all night and keep on your toes on the job, isn't it?
Well, if you mean I'm neglecting my duty, I'm not.
By the way, Stevens, you seen that bootlegger Tony Morelli lately?
Morelli? Sure, seen quite a bit. Matter of fact, I saw him last night.
What time was that?
Oh, about 9:30. Somewhere around then.
Somebody bumped him off last night.
What? Say, what do you know about that? How was it done?
Somebody pumped three slugs into him. One through the head, one through his heart, and a third in the abdomen. Pretty thorough job.
Got any idea who did it?
You're under suspicion, Stevens.
Me? I didn't have anything to do with it.
Can you prove it?
Sure. As a matter of fact, I was with some people all evening. They'll tell you I was.
You mind if I ask you for your gun for a minute?
What? No, of course not. Yeah.
Thanks. Sounds like coal oil. You just cleaned it, didn't you, Stevens?
Yeah, I did. But that's simple enough to explain. I was taking some pot shots at a bunch of tin cans out at the barbecue last night. You know, practicing up on my shooting.
Well, that may be perfectly true, Stevens. We're simply checking up on everything. Tony's brother Joe says that you did it. Would you mind if we had him and Tony's wife in here to talk to you?
Certainly not. Tony's brother doesn't like me, so of course he'd accuse me. But I want to get this thing cleared up. Bring him in.
Bring in Mrs. Morelli and Joe Morelli.
This is funny. Me, an officer of the law, getting accused by a bootlegger of murder. I thought things like that only happened in detective novels.
You're wrong there, Stevens. However, we'll have it all out as soon as they arrive. That's the best way to settle it. Yes?
Mr. and Mrs. Morelli are out here.
Bring them in.
Right in here, please.
Come in, Mrs. Morelli. You know Officer Stevens.
Yes. I know him. You bet I know him. What do you mean, my shooter, Tony? Is that not right to shoot anybody?
Oh, no, please, Miss Morelli, that won't help things at all. So just sit down now over here and try to be calm. I'm sure we'll get along a lot better.
I'm sorry, Mr. Policeman. try to keep it quiet.
I'm sure you will. That's right, in the chair, right here. I want to offer my sincere condolences to you, Mrs. Morelli, and I also to assure you that no matter what you think, I have nothing to do with your husband's death.
Well, suppose you just tell us what happened last night, Stephen.
Well, I picked Tony up about 9:30, and we started out for the party. We started, and we stopped and had a couple of drinks on the way, and finally Tony got so troublesome that I told him I wouldn't take him along with me.
What do you mean, troublesome?
Well, he got so drunk, he didn't know what he was doing.
Where'd you leave him?
Over to a place on Pleasant Street. We stopped for a drink with some friends of his, and I left him there.
Stevens, are you any witnesses that can swear to the fact that you're with him last night at all times?
I certainly have. Here, call this number and ask for Addie Spencer. I picked her up after I dropped Tony, and we drove out to Chatsworth to a barbecue.
Was anyone else with you?
Yeah, Ed Stickle, a friend of mine. We were together all evening.
All right, Stevens, what you say is the truth. Shouldn't be hard to prove it. I'm going to have these people you mentioned picked up and brought in. If they confirm your story, we'll start an investigation along different lines. Until then, however, I'm afraid you'll have to be placed in custody. That's the law, you know.
Oh, that's all right. I understand perfectly. Yeah, here's my badge and gun. I'll pick them up after you talk to the witnesses.
Seem pretty sure of yourself, Stephen.
Why not? I have a perfect alibi. That should be sufficient.
Alibi? Right, Stephen. Perfect alibi. We'll see.
Detectives Rico and Hamilton interview Stevens' witnesses and find his story substantiated in every way. They claim that they were in Chatsworth, where they stopped at a hotel and had some drinks with a party they knew. A check by police finds this to be true. Stevens indeed has the perfect alibi. Detective Rico never relaxes his vigil of checking Stevens' every move. And at last, although nothing is found wrong with Stevens' activities, the pressure is too great and he resigns from the force. Periodic checks on the ex-officer's moves fail to bring to light anything of importance, and then one day Stevens disappears from the city. And the Tony Morelli killing is placed in the unsolved files under the heading Gangster Killing. Time passes. 9 years roll by. New crimes occupy the headlines. New names appear on the police roster. The Tony Morelli killing is forgotten. Nothing remains but a musty paper in the police file. Then, one morning in the office, detective...
King speaking.
There's Mr. Spencer out here to see you, Lieutenant.
Did he say what he wants?
Well, he wants to see you, sir. He said it's something important.
All right. Send him in.
Yes, sir.
Spencer. Never heard that name before. Probably some guy with a petty complaint. I should have been out. Come in.
Lieutenant King?
That's right. Come on in. Thank you. Well, what seems to be your trouble, Mr. Spencer? That's right, isn't it, Spencer?
Yeah, that's right. I don't suppose you remember the name.
No, I can't say that I didn't.
I think you will. Anyway, I believe I have information for you that will solve one of your murders.
Yeah, what the devil do you mean?
I mean just that. If you're interested, I can tell you who killed Tony Morelli.
Tony Morelli? Oh, yes, that's that gangster killing.
My ex-wife was the principal witness in that case. She was half of the alibi, and now she wants to talk. I guess it's on her conscience. Anyway, she called me yesterday and told me that she had information that she couldn't hold any longer, so I came to you.
Where is your ex-wife, Mr. Spencer?
Well, she has a place out in Hollywood. Here's the address.
Excuse me a minute. Hello, Sergeant. I want you to take a couple of men and go and pick up a Mrs. Spencer. Get out a bench warrant for her and pick her up right away. She's in an apartment house at Hollywood and Virgil. Well, that's just in case she's changed her mind about telling what she knows. No, people have a way of doing that.
Yeah, I imagine they do. She's probably scared anyway. It's no fun hanging under a secret like that for so long a time. Liable to drive a person batty.
Here. Tell you what you do, Mr. Spencer. Suppose while we're waiting for the boys to bring her in, you make out a report to me in this car here. Just a matter of routine, of course, but it's necessary.
Oh, sure. I don't like the idea of having my name floating around police headquarters, but if you're needed, it's okay with me. Just answer these questions?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, let's see. Name? Tom Spencer. Occupation? None at the moment.
Spencer, how does it happen that you kept this from the police all these years?
Oh, you don't know what a tough man he is. He just as soon kill me as eat. I was afraid to say anything.
You realize, of course, that if you'd have told the truth in the first place, we'd have laid our hands on Stephen. But now no one knows where he is.
Oh, I know it was wrong. I wanted to tell, but I was so afraid of him. Honestly, Lieutenant, he's the worst man I ever heard of.
Suppose you try and tell me in detail just exactly what did happen that night. And if you can remember exactly what was said, it'll be a great help.
Well, it was around 10 o'clock in the evening. I was expecting Stephen. And so when the doorbell rang...
Hi, Addie. I got a friend with me. He's going with us. Tony, this is Addie Spencer. Addie, meet Tony Morelli.
How do you do, Mr. Morelli? Come in, won't you?
No, we haven't got time. Get your things and come on out the car. We're going out to Chatsworth and have a time.
Well, come in and have a drink first. It'll take me a minute to get my face on.
All right, if you say you got a drink, we'll come in with pleasure. Huh, Tony?
You bet you're my life. That's a good idea. Yes, sure. It's a wonderful thing, this liquor.
Don't mind Tony, Addie. He's a little drunk, but it's all right.
It's all right with me. Not too sober yourself.
What do you mean I'm not sober? You don't think the few drinks I've had tonight are going to flatten me, do you?
Well, I've never seen you when you weren't that lit, but I don't care.
I'd have been, sure. What do you care for anyway, huh? Stevens, he's a good fella, sure, sure. He's a very good fella, even if he's a cop, yeah.
All right, Tony, keep your thoughts to yourself.
Huh?
I told you I didn't want you to go around sprouting about mine being on the force. Not good business.
Here you are, boys. Wrap yourselves around these while I get a bit of powder on. I'll only be a minute.
Well, Tony, happy, happy.
That's right. Happy, happy. Come on, let's get drunk and break things.
No breaking tonight, Tony. Huh? We're out for a good time.
That's the trouble with you. All the time afraid that you have a little fun. You're just a lot of talk.
Yeah. Listen, Tony, if you weren't so drunk, I'd show you how much talk I am.
Well, I'm not half so drunk as you think, huh? I'm not so drunk. I don't remember a couple of things you told me that you wouldn't want certain people to know.
Shut up.
What's the matter, huh? You afraid I'm going to spill it, huh?
Tony, for the last time, Tony, keep that mouth of yours shut or I'll shut it permanently.
Ah, what's the matter?
Here. What do you boys want to be arguing for? Come on. Finish those drinks and let's go.
Okay, Addie. But remember, Tony, I'm not fooling about what I said. If you want to remain healthy, keep your mouth buttoned.
Okay, I'm sorry,
All right, forget it. Come on, Addie, we're off in a cloud of smoke. You and Tony get in the back seat, Addie. We're picking up Ed Sickle. He's going with us.
Who's he?
That's some more of your business. Pile in, Addie.
All right, come on.
You all set back there?
Sure, we're nice and happy, eh, Eddie?
Oh, sure.
Sure. Everything is all right now. I'll bet you my life.
How do you like the way this bus rambles?
I think you're driving too fast. Remember, you've been drinking.
Yes, all right. Hey, listen. What would your policeman friends say if they caught you? I wouldn't like that, eh?
Oh, lay off of him, will you?
That's right, Annie. Stick up for Papa.
Sure. A very funny picture that would make, huh? Promising a younger police officer arrest for a driving while drunk.
Wise guy.
What's up now?
This is where we pick up Ed, that's all.
Hey, Ed. Hey, Ed. Come on, make it fast.
He went quicker. Hold everything.
You remember Ed, don't you, Eddie?
Sure, I know him well.
Not too well, I hope.
Oh, don't be silly.
Okay, open the doors and let me in. Hello, Eddie. How's things?
Hello, Ed. Not bad.
Ed, the guy in the back is Tony Morelli. Tony, meet Ed Stickle.
Sure, I'm glad to meet you.
Yeah. Where are we heading for?
Out to Chatsworth. There's a barbecue out there. I thought we might take it in and get a bit blind. Might be fun.
Yeah. You're not doing too badly by that getting blind business right now. How many are down tonight, huh?
Not so many. I'm all right.
Sure, he's a plenty drunk, yeah. Hey, he's the thing I'm a drunk. But he's the one that takes the drunk, you know. He's just a big flat to put on the loot.
Tony, I'm telling you to shut up, and I mean it for the last time, Terry.
Hey, what's the matter with you? Can't you take a little joke?
This is no joke. Are you going to keep that trap shut?
Hey, watch yourself, Charlie. You're in the 9th Street Bridge, you know. Not out in the sticks somewhere.
I don't care where I am. I'm tired of that guy back there making crack at me.
Just a couple that can't take it.
Hey, why What's up, Charlie?
Are you going to stop laughing at me? Look out, Eddie. That's what I do to guys I don't know when to stop. Come on, drag that dirty rat out here in the gutter. Finish him, Ed. Take this gun.
Okay.
A couple of guys there, and we're going to buy them a few drinks, see? That way, I'll have a perfect alibi. Unless you decide to yap. And if you know what's good for you, keep it shut.
And that's about all of it, Lieutenant.
Yeah, and you've been going around for 9 years with that knowledge? Then it doesn't do any good for us to cry about it now.
Lieutenant, will you lock me up in jail?
Of course not, Mrs. Spencer.
But I want you to. I'm afraid of Stevens. If he's liable to get wise that it was me that talked and find me, I'm afraid to go home.
Now, don't you worry, Mrs. Spencer. We'll see that you have all the protection that's needed. I'll have a couple of men with you all the time until we fix Stevens up. Send in Officers Nolan, Fitzgerald, and Filkes. I want to see them right away.
For murder, two men, Ed Stickle and Charles Stevens. The latter may be going under an alias. Description as follows. Number one, height 5 feet 10 and a half, weight approximately 140 pounds.
Set this up right away, Eddie. See that it makes the next edition. All citizens are asked to be on the lookout for two men by the names of Eddie Stickle and Charles Stevens. Descriptions are as follows.
And a few days later in the county jail, a turnkey happens to look at an index card.
Holy mackerel. The guy on this card ain't that Stickler fellow that's wanted. I'll eat my hat. He's sitting right down there in tank four in a drunk charge. Won't he be happy when I tell him we found a murder rap on him?
Thus, the first of the two wanted men is found and booked on suspicion of murder. Under questioning, Stickler admits his participation in the shooting and verifies Addie Spencer's story. Within 5 days, his case is before the court. A first-degree murder verdict inevitable. As the scales of justice swing with the testimony of witnesses, there is no doubt in the prosecution's mind as to a conviction. But out of a clear sky, the testimony of the coroner in charge explodes like a bolt of lightning.
It has been proven in this court that the defendant, Edward Stickle, deliberately fired two shots into the body of one Tony Morelli. The defendant admits this to be the truth, but there can be no murder charge against him. In the testimony of the witness, it has been stated that the first shot was fired by Charles Stevens, the fugitive. This shot penetrated Morelli's brain, making death certain within a space of at the most 15 seconds. And the shots fired by the defendant were at least 30 to 60 seconds later. Therefore, Tony Morelli was already dead when the second bullet hit him, and you cannot murder a corpse.
Thus, in one of the most amazing reversals of testimony, Edward Stickle finds himself saved by a matter of 30 seconds. And the hunt turns once again with renewed interest to Charles Stevens, fugitive from justice. Clue after clue is run down only to prove to be a false alarm. Detectives follow a man answering Stevens' description halfway across the continent, only to find on close scrutiny that he is not the wanted suspect. Los Angeles, Lieutenant Betzner has discovered a man who knows Stevens. Together they rush to the High Sierras, where it is said that Stevens has a shack. But upon their arrival, they are told their man has eluded them by a matter of 10 hours, but that he had been seen buying a ticket to Sacramento on the train. Acting on this information, Lieutenant Betzner immediately wires Harry Hickok of the State Identification Bureau, telling him to be on the lookout for Stevens at the station. Hickok, wasting no time, gathers two of his associate officers and drives to the station, where they watch inbound trains arrive.
What time do you make it, Jim?
3:25 by my watch.
Right on time. Hey, you sure you know what this bird looks like?
Yeah, I got a picture of him here from the mug book.
Good. You don't want to take any chances of missing him. All the men set?
All set.
Keep your eyes open now. If you spot him, grab my arm and we'll net him before he has a chance to pull anything.
Right.
Oh,
Jim. You take him by the left arm. I'll grab his right.
Okay. Grab him.
Keep on walking, Stevens. We've got you.
Hey, what's the idea? You haven't got anything on me.
Are you coming along quietly, Stevens, or do we have to take you?
I don't know what you're talking about. What's the charge?
Grab those bracelets on him, Jim. Just for precaution's sake.
There you are, Mr. Stevens. Right where you belong. On the wrong side of a pair of police handcuffs.
Stevens has returned at once to Los Angeles, where he is scheduled to face trial on a charge of first-degree murder. All through the preliminary days of the trial, he sits smugly listening to the testimony, steadfastly denying any knowledge of the crime. But in the minds of the police, this man is no ordinary criminal. He is a fellow officer who has violated his trust. And finally, as the last rays of sun are filtering through the windows into the hushed courtroom, Charles Stevens, ex-officer and murderer, stands silently in front of Judge W.V. Tryon to receive his sentence.
You thought because you wore a police uniform that you were beyond the law. You violated your oath to enforce law and order. You violated the commandment, thou shalt not kill. You sought immunity from your crimes behind the uniform you disgraced. But the law applies to every one of us, to the policeman as well as to the civilian. Because you acted beyond the law, Charles Stevens, and killed a man not in the line of duty, you are to pay the extreme penalty. I sentence you to be hanged by the neck until death.
Stevens appealed the decision in the highest court of the land, and as a result, his sentence was commuted by the governor to life imprisonment. We in the police department are faced daily by proof that crime never pays. So it is a rare exception when a member of our own organization steps outside the law, as did ex-officer Charles P. Stevens, whose story has just been told. Our relentless pursuit and capture of the man proves that even those on the inside cannot commit crime and get away with it. In an organization such as ours, numbering over 2,500, the law of averages selects some men who are too weak to resist the temptations which daily beset underpaid and unappreciated policemen. Our men, jealous of their reputation for integrity, are quick to oust any offender against our code.
Thank you, Chief Davis. As this half hour draws to a close, may I emphasize what I told you at the beginning of this program. Rio Grande cracked gasoline lifts you out of the realm of the ordinary. It is the only gasoline you can buy that gives you police car performance. Thousands of motorists are finding this out and will never again be satisfied with slow-burning, sluggish, undramatic gasoline. Rio Grande Cracked has recently made greater gains than any gasoline on the Pacific Coast. Thousands of motorists are learning, too, that they can't buy better motor oils than those sold by Rio Grande independent dealers. Sinclair, Pennsylvania, and Sinclair Opaline. Both de-waxed, both de-jellied, both refinery-sealed and tamper-proof tanned. And here is an announcement of extraordinary importance. If you are saving police money for junior detective and G-man outfits, turn in your coins before December 31st. All these free gifts are illustrated in Calling All Cars News, that thrilling publication of movie, radio, and detective stories. Get a copy from your nearest independent Rio Grande dealer, and be sure your request for free gifts is postmarked before midnight, December 31st.
Lieutenant, please, calling all cars. Attention, all cars. A cancellation broadcast 159. Suspect in this case is now in custody. That is all, Harmon.